Well, we just have some news coming across that where there are reports the White House is drafting an emergency declaration to get the wall funding, meaning they're going to go around Congress. So joining me now, former federal prosecutor Joseph Moreno, who served in the Justice Department's National Security Division. Joe, I know we were talking about the Mueller probe here, but with this latest developments, explain to our audience about a president declaring an emergency and the threshold that allows him to go around the legislative branch entirely.
Sure, Richard. So it's certainly a provocative move by the president if the reporting is to be believed. So based on a law from Congress called the National Emergencies Act, which was passed in the 1970s, that law, along with a few others, give the president some very broad powers to declare a national emergency. Unfortunately, the law does not really precisely define what constitutes a national emergency, and so the president has a lot of latitude there. Nor is there a really effective mechanism for Congress to stop him. The law was originally built with a sort of majority veto power, but that was struck down by the Supreme Court. So really, the president has a lot of authority to declare a national emergency. And if the reporting is to be believed, the president is looking to possibly use military construction funds to fund the border wall during this national state of emergency, if in fact he follows through with this reporting.
And by the way, in previous iterations of this conversation, he had talked about taking funding from Puerto Rico's rebuild, as well as also other very controversial places to take it. You would think it wouldn't sit well with the legislative branch, regardless of the lawmakers, because it totally voids their role as a co-equal branch in the government. So as they say, stay tuned. We will follow that. Okay. Let's get to the ongoing saga that is Michael Cohen and Donald Trump. I want to play a couple sound bites here, and I want to get your impression if this crossed the line, if not leapfrogged the line, into witness tampering. But again, this is the president and this Michael Cohen. Michael Cohen expected to have testified before the Senate here as it related to, obviously, what he knew under testimony. Let's first take a listen to the sound bites.
He should give information maybe on his father-in-law, because that's the one that people want to look at.
So it's okay to go after the father-in-law?
Now, of course it is. If the father-in-law is a criminal, we talked about Ukrainians, his father-in-law is a Ukrainian. His father-in-law has millions and millions. Of course it's not. I'm telling you, it comes from the Ukraine. The reason that's important is he may have ties to something called organized crime.
Okay. So you have both the president's attorney, the president himself, and then as a consequence, we saw Michael Cohen saying for fear for his family, safety or otherwise, he was going to withdraw his offer to testify. I want to now play the clip. This is Michael Cohen's attorney, Lanny Davis, responding to what he heard from the president and explaining his client's actions.
The House of Representatives now has an obligation, a resolution of censure when the President of the United States indisputably intimidates and obstructs justice to prevent a witness from testifying is an order. So is a federal criminal investigation of Rudy Giuliani for witness tampering.
Well, I wouldn't hold my breath for the actual censure here, but I guess my question, Joe, is, now you already have the Senate saying, hey, we're going to subpoena you. Now, it might be behind closed doors, but talk to two parts of it. What happens next for Michael Cohen? But first, that the president of the United States sounds like basically a B-movie mobster talking about the wife and the father-in-law of someone that's testifying under oath to Congress.
Richard, I have used the word inappropriate for many times on air over the past couple of years with respect to the president's tweets and some of the things he said about the special counsel, Paul Manafort, Michael Cohen. Just the fact that he weighs in on investigations alone is inappropriate. But we have really gone beyond that level with these last few comments. Impugning an individual's father-in-law, making intimations that he's tied to organized crime, calling someone a liar, it would be inappropriate to describe any witness by anyone, much less the president of the United States, and much less when that witness is looking to testify before Congress in a few weeks. So it is really just grotesquely improper to see this from the president and his attorney. Now, will there be ramifications from it? That's hard to say. I mean, if these statements were made in private, think about how badly they would sound. But the fact that they're made in public, you know, it doesn't make them any better, certainly, but it almost kind of takes away some of the element of secrecy where the president can say, well, look, it's just my lawyer making some statements. I don't actually mean to threaten anyone. But so whether or not there are legal implications, it's yet to be seen, but it's really, really just so highly improper and so contrary to what we expect from our leaders.
Now, I've heard Adam Schiff from the House Intel Committee saying he's going to reserve the right to maybe subpoena, but at least the Intelligence Committee at the Senate level has shown, to be fair to Senator Barr from North Carolina, the Republican, an interest in bipartisanship and really taking this probe seriously, unlike when Nunes ran the House Intel Committee before the midterms. To that end, what happens behind closed doors and how much of it will get shared with the American public?
Well, first off, I mean, you're right. The Senate has definitely had a better reputation in the past 2 years under Republican control than the House has in terms of just the perception that the Senate was working bipartisan in a bipartisan nature and really following through, where the House was criticized as sort of slow walking a lot of the investigation. So I give credit to the Senate for following through here. Now, what they can actually get out of Michael Cohen, that's more of an open question, because really I have to think that Michael Cohen is not going to be really at liberty to get into a lot of details about what the special counsel is still investigating. So whether it's open door or closed door, and it probably will be closed door, you're right, I have to think there's going to be a lot of areas regarding Russia and the Trump campaign and the 2016 election he's just not going to be at liberty to get into in detail. And that's likely to frustrate a lot of members of Congress, but that's the reality. As long as the special counsel's probe is continuing, you really don't want witnesses who might know what evidence he has and what direction he's going to be out there making statements, even if it's to Congress, because leaks are always a possibility.
Finally, Joe, I'm curious. The amount of people who, that I respect, have legitimate concerns as to whether or not we are ever going to see the entirety of the report from Mueller surprises me. I mean, I believe in this day and age where three people can't keep a secret other than, you know, Mueller and his team, you could argue. I believe there's an inevitability to it. But if you follow some of, and not just the tinfoil hat folks, that Barr gets confirmed and either he will redact the heck out of this report here or it won't be made public. What is your sense? Whenever, and I've been wrong 30 times as to when we're going to finally get the report, but when the report is finally delivered to the Attorney General, do you believe it's just a matter of when, not if, we the people get to see it?
Rich, Bill Barr spent, 9 hours testifying at his confirmation hearing last week. But yet the two most important points that people kept drilling him into was, one, will you interfere with the investigation? And two, will you release the results? And those are good questions. I think he did a decent job at saying, look, I am committed to transparency. I will do everything I can to make sure that as much of whatever report I get sees the light of day. That being said, that was not quite enough for a lot of critics. And so you're right. There are people who are out there who are still saying, you know, I'm just not sure I got the feeling from the next potential attorney general that he is in fact going to do the right thing. So I personally felt like he did a really nice job addressing those concerns. But you're right, there's a lot of people out there, in all fairness, who feel like, I believe it when I see it. I think there's going to be a tremendous amount of political pressure, much of the report as possible. But ultimately, it will be up to the attorney general as to how much he believes the public should see.
And we shall see. Hey, Joe, I appreciate the time. Thank you so much.
Richard, always a pleasure.
All right, everyone, coming up next, the shutdown, as you know, continues, which means the State of the Union address is on ice till it's resolved. Shockingly, the president blinked. We're going to show you how we got to this point and why the president at the end backed down to Nancy Pelosi.